the index card, a few simple rules.
And that just seemed much more doable to a lot of people.
So what's on the card? Rule one, strive to save 10 to 20% of your income. Though rule one is easier advised than accomplished.
We're gonna discuss the all the financial advice you'll ever need fits in a single index card. That started as a blog post. It was, I know I've seen it on Pinterest and other social media. And Harold Pollack, a UC Chicago social scientist, came up with this idea. He's been on PBS, on different shows, and he wrote a book about it to further explain each of the issues. So there's 10 issues or 10 pieces of advice. We're going to look at each of those 10 pieces.
So just kind of to give you our thoughts on the first one. So mine personally, starts off talking about saving. So saving 10 to 20% of your income. I think it's good advice if you can do it, but there's not many people that can. That's the tricky part, is it is good advice, but it's not practical for a lot of people. You know, if you're struggling to pay your rent, to put gas in your car, you know, pay for childcare, food, whatever it is, putting away 20% of your income just isn't realistic. But if you've made it to the point where you're more comfortable and you can afford to do that, it makes more sense to put money into savings than it does into buying the latest iPhone or something like that.
Or vehicles, think about sure. It with vehicles, housing. I agree. It's if you want to retire, I mean, they say if you put 10% away, you'll need to do that for about 50 years to be able to retire. If you can put away 20%, 35 years. But I agree, depending on where you live, income, your family situation, it may not be consistent, but at some point, maybe you're doing a lot more than 10 or 20%, you know, later in your career or when kids are gone.
Yeah, so overall, I think good, good advice.
Yeah, but good goal.
Yeah, yeah.
Rule two. Pay your credit card balance in full every month. Obvious, yet less than a third of Americans follow this rule.
Okay, so this one, like it says, it's kind of obvious. You know, if you do use a credit card, paying it off, every month makes sense, so you're not paying interest. You know, that's kind of a no-brainer. I think maybe not using a credit card unless you already have a plan in place to pay it off every month is important.
Use it for the convenience of it.
Yeah, exactly.
But not as a loan.
Exactly.
Because, think about your loans. If you're spending beyond your income, maybe a collateralized loan like a house or cut spending. I mean, I'm surprised a third of people carry a balance on their credit cards. I think the other points with credit cards is there's a lot of attractive free frequent flyer miles or attractive things to lure you in. It's not a cost-effective way to, you don't want to hold a balance or deal with those charges.
Right, yeah. A better way to state it might be, don't use that credit card for a purchase unless you have the cash in your bank account to pay for it right then.
Right, use debit cards if it's a credit card issue.
Exactly.
And then if you do carry balances, of course, think of the highest interest first. You can roll balances, but that usually costs about 4% to roll. So it's, even if they're free 0% for a year, you're paying 4 to 5%.
Three. Max out your 401k and other tax-advantaged savings accounts. To this day, only 12% of Americans do this.
All right, with maxing out, sure, that goes along with number one, save what you can. Of course, depending on where you are in life, income, expenses, that could be harder to do. Also, if you're contributing to retirement plans, these tax-deferred accounts, there can be big penalties, 10% if you pull it out ahead. So make sure you're not putting more than you can afford to into these tax-deferred accounts so you don't get penalized.
Yeah, it kind of goes hand-in-hand with the savings. If you can do it, great.
Yeah.
Especially if it's a plan where there's an employer match, definitely contribute enough to get the match. Otherwise, you're just giving money away.
Rule four, never buy or sell individual stocks. Because less than 1% of us have the ability to consistently outperform the market.
For this, I would say it's not a hard and fast rule. There are certainly situations where buying individual stock makes sense in a portfolio. So I wouldn't say that that's a good hard and fast rule.
I think it's a good guideline if you're just, you know, if you don't know much about the market or balancing accounts. And in general, I guess trying to outperform the market by buying individual stocks doesn't make sense. So there is a lot of shows, a lot of people pushing, timing the market or pick these stocks because they know better than the market, you know, what's going on with them. I think buying individual stocks in good companies, having enough stocks to make a diversified portfolio or fill a gap, and holding them, buying for the long run, I think it's a fine strategy.
The premise of it that your average individual investor is not good at timing the market, or, you know, even professional investors at that. So, you know, that's not a proven strategy, but it doesn't mean that, you know, there's never a time when it would make sense.
Right, right.
So rule five, buy inexpensive, well-diversified mutual funds and exchange-traded funds. Index funds, that is. And hold them.
Yeah, that's good guidance, sure. Inexpensive, definitely look at that expense ratio, what the charges are. That goes along with the last one, that if you can't outperform the market, it doesn't make sense to pay some fund to be trying to outguess the market. It's not a proven strategy.
Yeah, it's a good general guideline, I think. I would agree with that, pretty simple.
Insist your investment advisor, if you have one, commits to a fiduciary standard, putting the client first, instead of the suitability standard, which requires no such commitment.
I think this one is absolutely true. It's a no-brainer. It doesn't make sense paying somebody for advice if they're trying to sell you something. It makes no sense.
Yeah, you want to make sure that they do sign a fiduciary commitment, that they're putting your interests first, that they're not just trying to sell some annuity or products, and that could end up costing you. And even if it's small percentages over the long run, that's what they were illustrating with the cakes, that over the long run, it takes a piece out of your retirement.
Yeah, it's like walking onto a car lot and then paying the salesperson to help you pick a car. It doesn't make sense.
Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Make sure they're unbiased. Fiduciaries, fee only is another term.
Rule seven, buy a home only when you're financially ready.
Yeah, I like this rule. I think a lot of people look at rent as wasting money, but don't look at the interest they're paying, the taxes they're paying, the other expenses with owning a home. And it's a big commitment. A 15 or a 30 year mortgage is a long commitment. So, you know, make sure you can commit to a location, that you're not going to buy it and then need to sell it in a couple years. And you could take a big hit. It's a big leveraged investment. You only need to put, you know, 20% down. And if there's fluctuations in that housing market, there's going to be costs for realtors, there's going to be costs for appliances that you're going to have to, you know, that real estate's going to need to grow to cover it. So, and it's not a sure thing that and especially in a short time period, that you're going to make up the difference.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think, you know, banks and the mortgage industry and real estate agents, their industry, they try to promote this idea that, you know, you got to buy a house, you got to do it right away, it doesn't matter, you know, it's always the best way to go. And for a lot of people, it's proven that is not actually the best thing to do. So you really have to take a hard look at that financial situation and see if it makes sense for what you're going to be doing. So yeah, don't want to buy a house unless it's actually the right choice for that particular situation.
And it's more than just a financial decision, too. I mean, I love not owning a house. It's freeing. You can move without thinking about it. So there's other issues to consider.
Right. Yeah.
Eight, insurance. Make sure you're protected.
Yeah, this one makes sense. Obviously, you know, if you have some sort of catastrophic event and you don't have insurance in place to cover it, it could be financially devastating. So making sure you have enough insurance, but not too much, that's good. So you want to, of course, look at the coverage that you have, review that periodically, get other quotes periodically to make sure that what you're paying is kind of in line with what's reasonable. And just keeping on top of that is important.
Yeah, that's what we usually think of it as. You're trying to cover things that you can't self-insure or cover yourself. So, of course, auto liability, homeowners, life insurance only if you have dependents. It's not a money-making scheme, so you don't need to go out and get insurance or life insurance if you don't need it. Have high deductibles, insure what you can, self-insure.
Mm-hmm. Nine, the most controversial on the card, do what you can to support the social safety net.
This one, I'm not 100% sure what he's getting at. I mean, if you live in America and you have income, you're required to pay taxes on it, so you don't really have a whole lot of choice as far as that goes. Now, I don't know if he means supporting other organizations voluntarily.
Well, they further went on just to talk about, they mentioned Medicare, Social Security, you know, the government supporting. So, yeah, like you say.
It's not optional.
Don't cheat your taxes.
I guess. I'm not really sure the point of that one.
But sure. Safety net's nice in society.
Mm-hmm. And finally, 10, remember the index card.
You have to be methodical and stick to this.
Yeah, I think this is a great point. You make a plan, but you got to keep up with that plan. We used to have clients come in and we just give them advice, do consulting, and leave it on them to follow through. They'd come back a year later and they're in the same spot. So it's, you really need some accountability. Everyone's going to be a little different about what that means. Some people are real disciplined and will keep up with that, but some people need to check in, need to make sure they're following with their plan.
Definitely. Yeah, that's one of the big benefits of working with a financial planner, financial advisor, is that you have somebody who's actually going to take over that discipline for you. They're going to help you with that side of it. So, they schedule those meetings with you. They make sure that you're putting that plan to practice rather than just letting it go. Yeah, all which right. is easy to do when you're busy.
So, it's always a top priority.
Not necessarily fun to do either. Yeah.
So thanks for watching. Please let us know if you like these, if you have any comments, if you have any suggestions. Subscribe, like, visit our website.
Yeah, all that stuff. All right, thanks.
Thanks.